You called for light out of darkness. You don't need a man to be the God you are, but you have chosen to call me your own.
Wow, it's yet another time where we bring the word of the Lord to you. So it's another time when we come into your houses, we come at your places of work, and we bring the word of the Lord to you. And we are confident that the Lord has kept you safe. The whole of this week we've been focusing entirely on exercising dominion, and I've been looking at that which you need to know, that which you need to have in your quiver before you can start exercising dominion, because dominion will not operate in a vacuum. There must be something that you know, there must be an understanding that you have, there must be knowledge that has entered into you. The Bible tells us in Psalm 119:130 that the entrance of the word of God bringeth light and gives understanding to the simple. So there is that light, there's that understanding that must come into us to be able to exercise dominion. And up to where we are, I feel we've moved right, we've moved on well. And as we sum up the week, I want to look at one scripture only today. It's in the book of Job, chapter number 38 and verse number 33. Job chapter number 38 and verse number 33. The Bible says this: God is speaking to Job after, you know, everything that Job has gone through. And now God is speaking to Job, and in verse number 33, he asks Job, "Do you know the laws of the heavens? And can you institute the dominion of God here on the earth?" Two things. Do you know the laws of the heavens? And can you institute, can you establish the dominion of God on the earth? Do you know the laws of the heavens? And can you institute the dominion of God on the earth? Now, hear me, child of God, that the dominion that we are talking about is not just when we prevail in a particular area alone, but it is when we prevail consistently, convincingly, in a particular area of our domain. And we tackle that on Wednesday, that a particular area of our domain, our territory, when we are able to know that this is our domain, this is our territory, this is our area, this is where we function the best. Now, when we are able to know that, now we can now move to the next steps, and we can move to the next things. And for this broadcast today, I want to look at the laws of the heavens, the laws of the heavens. Now, understand, the Bible will tell us that the heavens and the highest of the heavens, that is Psalm 115, verse number 16, they belong to God, but the earth he has given to man. So understand that there are laws that you need to understand. You know, the Bible will tell us that when Adam and Eve were created, God gave them dominion. Our base scripture has been Genesis 1 and verse number 26, that God wanted them to have dominion. And we see God allowing that dominion to play out in the lives of Adam. When we go to Genesis chapter number 2 and verse number 19, and God brings all the animals, and whatever name Adam would give to the animals, that name has stuck until today. Why? Because when God releases his dominion, he releases dominion with a lot of confidence, and he expects the original intent of God is that he expected and he still expects us to walk and to move and to articulate dominion over the earth. So understand, there are laws that were created by God himself, and these laws now they govern or they are the laws upon which our dominion is exercised. So dominion is not exercised in a vacuum. No, dominion is exercised because there are some certain laws that are put in place for us to be able to, you know, marry or be able to partner with these laws, and we will see the dominion of God being able to be established here on the earth. So God asked Job, "Do you know the laws of the heavens? Because if you would know the laws of the heavens, you will be able to establish the dominion of God here on the earth." So I need to understand, child of God, this is why, you know, that Paul is saying that we are now using the wisdom of God, which is not like the wisdom of the earth, because if the rulers of the world, the rulers of the synagogue, synagogues, the rulers of the times of Jesus, if they had the wisdom, they would not have crucified him. But the kind of wisdom that they were using, you know, worldly wisdom. But as long as you have known the Lord Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior, now you step into the kingdom of God, and in the kingdom of God, there is the wisdom of God that operates, there is the wisdom of God that is supreme, there is the wisdom of God that is the principal thing, and this is the wisdom that the Bible talks about in Proverbs chapter number 8. The entire chapter is talking about the wisdom of God and the exploits of this wisdom. Now hear me, child of God. James will tell us in James chapter number 1 that if any one of us lacks wisdom, let him ask of the Father who freely gives to everyone who asks. If every one of us lacks wisdom, let him ask of the Father who gives to everyone freely. He gives to everyone, whoever asks. And he says that this wisdom is not like the earthly wisdom. This wisdom is higher than earthly wisdom. Now for us to be able to exercise dominion, we must be willing, we must be ready to move from earthly wisdom and be ready to drink from the fountain of divine wisdom. Because when you look at God, the way he does his things, he does not do his things conventionally like we do our things here in the world. And I will prove it. God has used people according to the standards of the world and according to the standards of the earth. These people are not the right people that God would have used. And I will bring just a few of them. You know, God has used Abraham to become our father of faith. But Abraham and his wife, they didn't have a child. You know, his wife was barren. And this doesn't look like the kind of a family that God would use, you know, to prove, to anchor us as far as matters of faith are concerned. God has used a woman like Rahab or Rahab. And now when you go to Hebrews chapter number 11, there are a few women that, you know, make it to the book or to the, you know, to the Hall of Fame, Hebrews 11. One of them is Rahab. And by all means, this woman was a prostitute. If God were to, you know, like teach us about faith, I don't see why he should have used people like Rahab. There are some other people that we find in the Bible also, you know, that they keep appearing, but they were not the right people. Look at someone like David. By all means, David is not the right example for anyone, but, you know, he had this heart that was united with the heart of God, and for that, the Lord used him. So understand, God does not do things, you know, he does not operate by the wisdom that governs things here on the earth. He used what I would say, the laws of the heavens, the wisdom that is divine, the wisdom that is first of all pure, the wisdom that is above in hierarchy to the wisdom of the earth. So if you run your life by the wisdom of the world, you will realize that you will not prevail, because the wisdom of the earth, the wisdom of the world has its limitations, it has its gaps, it has its vacuums. But the wisdom of God is complete. The wisdom of God does not have, you know, it doesn't have vacuums, it doesn't have gaps, it doesn't have spaces. It is complete, because this is the wisdom by which the universe was created. So at the bedrock of creation is the wisdom of God. At the bedrock, at the foundation of creation is the wisdom of God. And this is the wisdom that runs the universe. It is the wisdom that runs the systems that are on the earth right now. It is the wisdom that has preserved everything to run, even as it is running right now. It is the same wisdom that has preserved that avocado trees have always been producing avocados until now, because the wisdom that created them, the wisdom that said, let there be, it is the same wisdom that has sustained them until now. Now, the wisdom that God used to create man in his image and in his likeness, it is the same wisdom that preserves man until now. But we have to plug into it for us to be able to be fruitful, for us to be able to multiply and increase, for us to be able to rule, for us to be able to exercise dominion over the fish of the sea and every other thing, every other aspect of creation. We have to plug ourselves into this wisdom so that we can be nourished from this wisdom and be able to manifest. Hear me, child of God. In John chapter number 15 and verse number 7, Jesus will tell the disciples that if you abide in me and my words abide in you, then you shall ask for anything that you desire and it shall be done for you. That if you abide in me and my words abide in you, then in verse number 8 he says, if you abide in me, then you will become very fruitful. And when you become fruitful, it delights, it pleases the Father. For us to be able to operate with the laws of the heavens and the wisdom of God, we must plug ourselves into God. We must plug ourselves into the wisdom by which he created us. We must plug ourselves into his blueprint. We must be in the socket of why and what and the hows he saw when he created us in his image and likeness. So God is telling Job that, do you know the laws of the heavens? Because when you know the laws of the heavens now, you will be able to establish the dominion of God in your workplace, in your marriage, in your relationships, in your career, in your plans, in your projections, in your prayers. You will be able to establish the dominion of God in your ministry, as you're doing your parenting, whatever dimension of life that you find and scope and sphere of life that you're in right now, you will be able to establish the dominion of God when you realize, when you understand, when you realize and understand the laws of the heavens. Now, let me read some scriptures for you here. Now, in Proverbs chapter number 24 and verse number 3 and verse number 4, the Bible will talk about, I call them the three girls. It will say that by wisdom a house is built. Through understanding, the house is established. But then through knowledge, the house is filled with all precious and pleasant riches. Now look at this. That wisdom will build the house. Understanding will make the house stand. In other words, wisdom will be the architecture for the house. Wisdom will draw the house. It will be built, it will be drawn. But then understanding will establish it to something that is visible. But now, the riches, all the pleasant things and the riches that are supposed to be in the house, the furniture and the beauty of the house is achieved through knowledge. Now, if you don't understand the laws of building, if you don't understand the laws, as Solomon says in Proverbs 24, verse number 3 and 4, if you don't understand that for you to build, you need wisdom, for you to establish, you need understanding, for you to fill the house with every precious and pleasant things, if you don't understand that that will be done through knowledge, anytime you try to build, it will never come to be, because there are laws that govern how you build and how you build and to how high you can raise a building. You need to understand, depending with the soil and the topology of the place where you're building your house, so many factors will come into play. You bring the geologist, they will tell you the structure here is like this, and so on and so forth. You bring in the architects, and they will tell you, for you to be able to build a 6-story building, we'll need to go down, this number of feet down, and to be able to raise it this high. So understand that God tells our Job, do you understand the laws of the heavens? Understand, child of God, nothing just happens. There are laws that govern the outcomes that we are looking for. There are principles that govern the outcomes, the desired outcomes. So for us to be when we look at the desired outcome that we're looking for in our lives, we must sit and ask ourselves, what are the laws that come into play as far as this is concerned? Marriage is governed by laws. Businesses are governed by laws. Politics are governed by law. Ministries are governed by law. Understanding and hearing God, there are laws that come into play. Parenting, there are laws that govern parenting. So I need you to understand, there are laws that once they are obeyed, they allow us to establish dominion. So we are not able to establish dominion without the understanding of the prevailing or the underlying laws. So if I'm starting a church, I must know that there are underlying laws to starting a church. If I'm starting a business, there are underlying laws to starting a business. If I intend to be married or to marry, I must understand that there are underlying laws. And these laws, once they are obeyed, now they bring the establishment of dominion here on the earth. Now, I'll be able to look at some of these laws. Now, the first law, it is the law of faith. It is the law of faith. Now, understand. Now, faith is a substance, Hebrews 11, verse number 1. Faith is a substance of things that are hoped for. It is the evidence of things that are not seen. Faith is a substance. Faith is the reality of what is unseen. Faith is the reality of what is unseen. Let me read some scriptures here so quickly. The book of Romans, chapter number 4, verse number 17. I'll read up to verse number 21. Romans 4, it says this so quickly. It says that as it is written, I have made you a father of many nations, talking about Abraham, before him who he believed, even God who quickens the dead. Even God who quickens the dead and calls those things that are not as though they were, who against hope. Now Abraham against hope believed in hope that he might become the father of many nations, according to what was that which was spoken, so shall thy seed be. And being not weak in faith, he considered not his body now dead, when he was about 100 years old, neither yet the deadness of Sarah's womb. He staggered not at the promise of God through unbelief, but he was strong in faith, giving glory to God. And this is uh, this
this is what it says in verse number 21. And being fully persuaded that what God had promised, God was also able to perform. That which God had promised, God was also able to perform. Now, and as a child of God, faith is a spiritual law. And there is nothing we will achieve in God without this faith. The Bible will tell us in Hebrews 11 verse number 6 that without faith, that he who comes to God must believe that he exists and that he is a rewarder of all those who diligently seek him. The B part of it says that without faith, it is impossible, not hard. Without faith, it is not complex. Without faith, it is impossible to please God. In other words, without faith, it is impossible to gain audience with God. I now understand why most of the times when Jesus would come into contact with people, he would ask them, do you believe that I can do this? The two blind men, you know, when they come to Jesus, and now in the book of Matthew, when they come to Jesus and they tell him, Master, we want to see. Jesus asked the two blind men, do you believe I can do this? And they told him, Master, we believe that you can do this. And Jesus told them, according to your faith, it is done for you. You notice that most of the people that Jesus prayed for, he kept saying, according to your faith, it has been done for you. He kept saying, according to your faith, or because of your faith, this has been done for you. And as a child of God, God tells John, do you know the laws of the heaven? In other words, do you know what makes dominion to be established? Do you know what provokes dominion? Do you know what makes people to exercise dominion on the earth? One of the laws that makes people to exercise dominion in the earth is the law of faith. It's the law of faith. Now, there's a man in Mark chapter number 9, if you read from verse number 23, and this man had an epileptic boy, and for a whole time when Jesus was up upon the mountain, he's being transfigured in the presence of the disciples. His disciples downhill, 11 of them, Judas included, Thomas included, Bartholomew included, and all the rest. This man had an epileptic son, and for a number of hours, he petitioned the disciples to cast out the demon of epilepsy, and the disciples could not. So when Jesus comes, he finds a commotion downhill or at the foot of the mountain, and he asks them, what is happening? Why are you arguing? What is the commotion all about? And the father of the son tells Jesus, I brought my son and I asked your disciples to cast out the demon of epilepsy, and the 11 of them, they've wasted my time, they could not cast out the demon. And Jesus looks at the disciples and he asks them, for how long am I going to be with you? In other words, you ought to have learned the craft by now. Because there is the law that would allow Jesus to cast out the demon so easily. It is the law of faith. When Jesus is standing beside the grave of Lazarus, his friend, in John chapter number 11, verse number 42, Jesus is making a prayer and he says, Father, I thank you that you have heard me. He makes the prayer, he says, also, Father, I thank you that you always hear me. Hear me. We will not be able to capture the attention of God without the law of faith. And the law of faith states that we must believe. Romans 4 verse number 21. The Bible has told us that Abraham believed that God was able to do that which he had said that he would do. Hear me, child of God, in our endeavor to exercise dominion as far as every sphere of life is concerned, be it finance, be it business, be it agriculture, be it marriage, whatever sphere of life, we must approach God with the attitude of faith that, Father, you are able to do that which you have said that you will do. I take you back to Mark chapter number 9. And this man is telling Jesus, Jesus, if you can. And Jesus is so insulted that he repeats the same words that this man uses. And Jesus looks at the father of the son and he asks the father, if I can. Then Jesus makes a very audacious statement and he says, all things are possible to they that believe. That all things are possible to they that believe. And the man says in verse number 24, Jesus, please help my unbelief. Help me to believe. And now Jesus heals and rebukes the demon of epilepsy in the son. Now this teaches me that as long as we can have faith, as long as we can believe, all things are possible, child of God. It is possible to raise that business of yours to become, you know, a business that employs more than 100 people. It is possible to raise your children and they become influential people here in this country and beyond the boundaries of our nation. It is possible to, you know, work in the place where you're working right now and you rise up the ladder, become the main person in that office, even though you are a cleaner right now, even though you're just a junior, a clerk in that office, even though you're just a junior, you know, as far as even the salaries are concerned, it is possible to rise up the ladder. How? The law of faith. And the law of faith states that which God has said he will do, he is well able to perform it. And this is now how you understand that when you have the law of faith, it doesn't see impossibilities, it doesn't see the traps, it doesn't see disappointment. The law of faith keeps on moving and knows he who has promised is faithful to fulfill what he has promised. Now, the second law that will govern and that will allow us to establish God's dominion here on this earth is the law of prayer. It's the law of prayer. Now, God in his sovereignty, he allowed that he has sat in on his throne to fulfill the requirements, the prayers, the desires of his children. But it is also the responsibility of his children to pray or to make the petitions. The Bible will tell you in Philippians 4:6 that do not be anxious about anything, but through prayer and petitions, let your requests be made known unto God. So this tells me that it is our responsibility to petition God. It is the responsibility of God to fulfill and to meet our petitions. Now, John will tell us that if we make our request known unto him, he is just and faithful to meet our request. That if we can pray, he is just and faithful to meet our request or to answer our request. If I read 1 John chapter number 5, the letter of John, verse chapter number 5, it says this, verse number 14. And this is the confidence that we have in him, that if we ask anything, a car, a marriage, a visa, a passport, you know, air travel, a business, you know, giving birth, whatever it is, becoming a manager where I'm a supervisor, whatever it is, if we can ask anything, this is the confidence that we have in him, that if we ask anything according to his will, he hears us. Verse number 15 says of 1 John chapter number 5, and if we know that he hears us, whatsoever we ask, then we also know that we have petitions that we have desired of him. Hear me, child of God. The second law that will govern and that will guarantee establishment of dominion in your sphere and scope of life is the law of prayer. That if we ask for anything in accordance with his will, he hears us, he responds. I want you to understand Psalm 65 verse number 2, that Jehovah is a prayer answering God. I don't know where people got this, and we were taught this when we were young. I'm surprised it is being taught even when people are old and are adults, that God answers prayers in three dimensions. One, he will either say yes. Two, he will either say no. Three, he can even say wait. I refuse. I know right now you're arguing in your mind and you're like, no, this preacher right now, I don't think he's right. Now, let's do this. Get your Bible right now. Show me those responses. Show me the no response. Show me the waiting response. Show me those dimensions in your Bible. Now, I want you to understand, whatever is a philosophical, something which is philosophically right, doesn't mean it is spiritually right. If God were to tell us to wait, it means either he is not in a position to give us now, or he doesn't have the power to give us right now. Whenever our prayers are not answered, most of the time I'm not able to teach you this, because I would have to take you to Matthew chapter number 6, and I'll be able to look at Jesus when he taught on prayer, and he taught us on the modalities of what governs prayers that will be answered. I'm not teaching that right now. We'll come back in a future broadcast. We'll be able to look at that. All I wanted to push through this hour is to say this. that prayer is a principle, is a law that governs the establishment of dominion here on the earth. So the Bible tells me in Psalm 65 verse number 2 that God answers prayer. Now you need to understand that he answers prayer in varying ways. And I think this is not what people try to interpret God, because at times Jesus would spit on the ground, take the mud and place it on people's eyes. At times he would lay his hands on them. At times he would just speak the word. At times he would tell them to, he would engage them in a prophetic action. He would tell them, go show yourselves, and as the people went, they will be healed. Now God answers in diverse ways, but one thing remains: the prayer is a law, it is a principle that governs the establishment of dominion here on earth. So John tells us in 1 John 5 verse 14 and 15 that whatever we ask for in prayer, Jehovah answers. So if you seek to rise in your place of work, pray. If things are not working right in your, as far as you and your husband is concerned, pray. If business is not doing right, pray. If you have fears and you've been threatened by whatever is happening around, pray. Prayer will bring dominion into your life. Prayer will establish dominion into your life. So the first principle we say is faith. So the prayer of faith. If you look at James chapter number 5, James chapter number 5 is a very interesting book after the book of Hebrews. James chapter number 5, he says this. Verse number 17, that Elijah was a man subject to like passions as we are, and he prayed earnestly that it might not rain, and it did not rain on the earth for the within the space of 3.5 years. Then it says also, and he prayed again, and the heavens, in verse number 18, and the heavens gave rain, and the earth brought forth her fruit. Now, verse number 16 will tell us the B part of it, that the effectual, fervent prayer of a righteous man availeth much. Notice, Elijah was a man like me and you, but he used the law of prayer. And when he used the law of prayer, he established dominion against Ahab as the king and Jezebel, and there was no rain in a span of 3.5 years. So I want you to understand that whichever area you want to dominate, whichever domain that you want to dominate in, there are principles that governs, and there are principles that will guarantee you to dominate. One of the principles is faith. The other principle is a principle of faith, is the law of prayer. So I want to say this, child of God, we cannot belittle prayer to just asking God for things. And your prayers must mature from, Father, give me, Father, do this for me. Your prayers now needs to mature to like the prayers of Elijah. Now, 1 Kings chapter number 17, verse number 1. 1 Kings chapter number 17. I want you to see this. 1 Kings chapter number 17. There's a reason why I'm reading the scriptures instead of just paraphrasing them. It says this, and Elijah, 1 Kings 17 verse number 1. And Elijah the Tishbite, who was of the inhabitants of Gilead, said unto Ahab, notice this is his prayer, as the Lord God of Israel liveth, before whom I stand, there shall not be dew nor rain these years, but according to my word. And he left, he went. A one statement prayer shut the heavens, not heaven, shut the heavens, the second heavens, for a span of 3.5 years. One simple prayer, and the prayer is, as long as the Lord liveth, before whom I stand, there shall not be rain for a span of 3.5 years, until I come back and say, let there be rain. And Elijah left. That was his prayer. The prayer was not I buy and lose, no. The prayer was not I declare, no. The prayer was not I shut, no. The prayer was not every spirit, every demon die by fire, no. The prayer was simply a prayer of a man that understood dominion. He understood who he was, created in the image and in the likeness of God. And this is the prayer that Elijah made. He says, until I come back and say otherwise, there shall not be rain. Hear me, child of God, our prayers must mature, our prayers must develop, and we move from childish prayers, we come now to prayers of sons. Thank you, Holy Spirit. Luke chapter number 15, verse number 13. Luke 15, I don't want to paraphrase today, it's the last day, allow me to read. Luke chapter number 15 and verse number 12. Now, verse number 11 opens up, Jesus opens up the parable, he says, and Jesus says, a certain man had two sons. Now, verse number 12 says this, and the younger of them said to his father, Father, give me the portion of goods that fall to me, or give me the part of the estate that is rightfully mine. And the father divided unto them his entire living. The younger son did not tell him, Father, I beg you, I beseech you, Father, please pity me. Father, I ask you and Father, I don't desire that you should answer me. Father, you know, I'm disqualified. You know, I'm just a piece of clay. Father, you know, I don't deserve, you know, I'm not. No, that is not what he said. Is the younger son understood dominion, and he goes to the father with a lot of audacity and braveness, and he tells the father, Father, part of what you have as you inherit, as your estate, as your resources, half of it belongs to me. Put it on my hand. And the Bible says in the same verse that the father gave half of his living, half of what he had gathered with sweat and labor, he gave it to the younger son. Now read verse number 29 and 30 of the same chapter. It says this. The elder son was mad, was angry, and he says to his father, Father, these many years I have served you, and I love the version that says, I have slaved for you all these years, and I have neither transgressed I at any time the commandment, and yet you have given, and yet thou never gavest me a kid, the young one of a goat, that I might make merry with my friends. But as soon as this scum, which has devoured thy living with harlots, thou hast killed for him the fattened calf. Now look at the response of the father. And the father said to him, Son, you are always with me, and all that I have is yours. There is a principle that will guarantee the resources of heaven into your hands. There is a principle that will hand over the riches and the wealth of our father into your hand. It is a principle, it is the law of prayer. This elder son never went to the father at any particular time and prayed. The younger son, in verse number 12, he went to the father and he prayed. And the father gave him 50% of his inheritance. So with him, because they were two, they divided it amongst themselves, 50-50. Let me say this, child of God. If you don't mature in your prayer life, you still remain in the level of prayer where you are just, Father, I ask. Father, I ask. There is a place and a time that comes that you understand the mind of the father. Because John told us in 1 John 5 verse number 14 that if we pray in accordance to his will. Now praying in accordance to his will is another dimension of prayer. It is not the dimension of prayer, Father, we ask that you can remove this. Father, we ask that you can do this. No. Because understand, when Jesus prayed that dimension of prayer, he brought in the issue of the will of God. That, Father, in this, I'm not so sure if it is your will, remove the cup from me. Remove the cup from me. But if it is not your will, then let your will be done, not my will. Understand, when we know the will of God, we don't petition, we command. I will say this again. When we know the will of God, when we know the will of God in a particular matter, we still don't ask him to do, we still don't, you know, request him to do, but we command it to happen. I will prove it. I will prove it. Acts of the Apostles, chapter number 3. I always love justifying what I say with scripture because my mind is not that gifted to be able to carry a sermon. I always love reverting to the Bible. Now, in Acts of the Apostles, chapter number 3, verse number 7. Let me start from verse number 6. Acts of the Apostles, chapter number 3, verse number 6. I will say this again. When we know the will of God, the mind of God in a particular matter, it is necessitated upon us that we don't go back to him, but because we know his will, we pray his will. We speak like he would have spoken. We pray like he would have prayed. Now, put your finger in Acts chapter number 3. I'll take you back to Luke chapter number 9. And verse number 1, the Bible says, then he called his 12 disciples together, and he gave them power and authority over all devils, and to cure diseases. And he sent them to preach the kingdom of God, and to heal the sick. So in the Gospels, Matthew chapter number 10, Acts chapter number 9, Mark chapter number 16, we find that Jesus gave the power and the authority over demons, over sicknesses, over diseases, over all of these things. Jesus released it into the hands of Peter, John, and the rest of the disciples. But they did not utilize it much while Jesus was alive. Apart from when we see them going out and they bring back a report, and Jesus said, do not be happy that demons are subject to you. Be happy that your names are written in the last book of life. But now after the departure of Jesus, they are now faced with reality and they need things to happen. And the first test they have is in Acts chapter number 3. In Acts chapter number 2, they've received the Holy Ghost. Now I have said this, that after you have known the will of God in a particular matter, it is now necessitated upon you that you exercise the laws that guarantees the establishment of dominion. Now, in verse number 6, verse number 5, you know, this cripple man, when he sees Jesus, when he sees Peter and James, Peter and John, verse number 4, he fastened his eyes upon them and, you know, and he's looking for alms. And Peter and John told him, look on us. In other words, there's something we have that we can give you. And in verse number 5, the cripple man looked at them, expecting to receive something of them. Then Peter said, silver and gold I do not have, but such as I have, I give unto you. In the name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth, rise up and walk. They did not say, Father, we ask you to heal this man. No, 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 no. They did not ask God to heal. No, they commanded the man to be healed. Why? It is a law that after I have known the will of God in a particular matter, I'm supposed now to take the next step and actualize the principles and the laws that will govern the outcome of the dominion that I want to see. Now, I take you back to Genesis chapter number 1 and verse number 26, even our wider from there. Genesis chapter number 1 and verse number 26. The Bible says, and God said, let us make man in our image and in our likeness. Now, hear me, child of God. He said, let us make man. The second thing that God said is, let them. The first thing he said, let us make man. He's talking to the council of heaven. He's talking to the council of heaven that this is my will, this is my intention, this is my desire. Let us create man in our image and in our likeness. Then God says, let the man have dominion over the earth. Let the man have dominion over the earth. I want you to understand that man is the being that has dominion here on the earth. When he starts taking up that mandate, God said, let them, let them, let them, let them. When you understand that the mandate of the let them mandate is on you, in your prayer life, it will not be a moment of just petitioning and requesting and asking. It will be a moment of instituting jurisdiction. It will be a moment of legislating in the spirit. It will be a moment of declaring in the spirit. It will be a moment of issuing decrees that are irrevocable. It is a law. It is a law. Look at the life of the Lord Jesus Christ. When they bring to him 5 loaves of bread and you know, and 2 fish, he does not say, Father, multiply. He takes both of them and he leaves and he gives thanks to the Father. He gives thanks to the Father. And then he gives to the disciples. What is he doing? He is exercising dominion. He knows it is my responsibility. As far as I'm here on this earth, it is the let them is on me. The assignment, the mandate, the let them mandate. And I want you to understand, child of God, there are things you're crying about, yet you're still the same person that has the solution to them. There are areas where you're confused, but you're still the man, you're still the woman that has the solution to that confusion. If you can step into your shoes of let them have dominion. So the first principle, the first law is faith. The second principle for this, you know, for this broadcast this week is the principle of prayer. See, the Bible will tell you in Hebrews chapter number 2, and the writer is quoting Psalms chapter number 8 from verse number 3 and 4. But the time we come to Psalms chapter number 8, verse number 6, the Bible tells us that God has placed everything under the feet, under the jurisdiction of a man. So you must understand the laws that govern outcomes. You must understand the laws that govern the outcomes of dominion. You must understand the laws that guarantees, you know, the manifestation of dominion. The second law that we are discussing this time is the law of prayer. And not prayer like, you know, Father, we ask, Father, we pray, Father, we ask, if it is your will, if it pleases you, no. It is a dimension of prayer where we know the will of God and we institute, we release that will of God to come and happen here on earth. Jesus says, whatsoever you shall ask the Father in my name, I will do it. I will do it. Elijah told Ahab, the God that answers by fire, that is a real God. And when you look at the prayer of Elijah in 1 Kings chapter number 18, it is not the kind of a prayer we pray right now, the prayer of pity, the prayer of a beggar's prayer. Father, please, Father, we ask, Father, when did you say you are going to come? Father, have you forgotten? Father, you know people will swallow me alive. Father, you know, we're making a lot of prayer that is a demonstration that we don't understand that the lesser mandate is with us. We are supposed to look at that situation. Look at Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego. They looked at the king and they told this king Nebuchadnezzar, King, please understand, if our God comes and rescues us, hallelujah. If he does not come, we are willing to die, but understand, we are not bowing our knees before you as a king or before any idol. There are men and women who knew who they are. So understand, child of God, that the other law that we will not be able to dive into so deeply because of, in the interest of time, that you must understand who you are and what has been invested in you. You are a son of God. So in your prayer life, you must pray like the son. Look at, check Luke 15 verse number 12 where we read, the younger son told the father, Father, commit into my heart the part of the estate that belongs to me. And the father released into his hands the part of the estate that belongs to him. It pleases the father when we understand who we are and what he has invested in us. He has invested in us his image and he has invested in us his likeness. And I beseech you by the mercies of God, go out there, dominate. In your prayer life, issue decrees, issue jurisdiction, declare, as far as I'm alive, there is no person in my family that will be barren. As long as I live, Elijah says in 1 Kings 17, verse number 1, where we read, he told the king Ahab and Jezebel, as long as the Lord lives, before whom I stand, there will be no rain. Issue jurisdiction. Declare things, command things, speak things that have weight. Make prayers that will change the dimension of your life. Make prayers that will affect the county. Make prayers that will turn around whatever wickedness is in the world right now. Make prayers that will bring a paradigm shift on the earth. Prayer is a law that shifts things in the heavenlies. Every strong man and woman of God we see in the Bible is a man and a woman of prayer. But when you look at their prayers, they're not prayers, you know, they're not prayers of people that are afraid of death. They're not prayers of people that are afraid of imprisonment. They're not prayers of people that are afraid of bankruptcy. No, they are prayers of men that have put on the shoes of dominion and they have squared their shoulders. They have lifted their head up on high. They know the one that has promised has never failed. You will not be the first one that he will fail. So if you'll exercise dominion in that business of yours, you must start making prayers of dominion. You must start making prayers that depict and prayers that demonstrate that you understand dominion. You will not make prayers, oh Father, you know, if you do not come, my business will shut. No, your business cannot shut before you shut it. So you must make prayers of dominion. If there are things that are missing in your life, make prayers of dominion. If there are aspirations that you have, desires that you have, all of us do. If you're a man that is looking forward to a better tomorrow, make prayers that demonstrate that you understand dominion. We are not praying like beggars, we are praying as sons. So understand, who are you? You are a son of God. And if you are a son of God, Galatians 4 verse number 5 tells us that you are entitled to the full rights of sonship. So faith, prayer, understanding who you are. God told Job, do you understand the laws of the heavens? Because if you did, you would establish the dominion of God here on the earth. I want you to understand, child of God, that God has allowed, let them have dominion. Let them have dominion. God has allowed that if there will be any big businesses that will rise out of the body of Christ, he has allowed a man and a woman operating from the understanding of faith, the principle of faith, to do that business. God has allowed. It pleases the Father. You know, Psalms 37 verse number 5, the Bible tells us that, that God honors the desires of our hearts. He honors the desires of our hearts. God honors the desires of our hearts. So it delights the Father that we can take dominion here on the earth, that we can establish His dominion here on the earth. It delights the Father that we would exalt the beloved. I desire that letter of John, verse number 2, that I desire that you may be in health, even as your soul prospers. It delights the Father. Jesus told the disciples that it is the desire, it is the delight of the Father to give you the kingdom. So hear me, child of God. Operate from the principle of faith. Let your prayers be prayers that have an understanding of who you are, have an understanding that you are a son of God, and then know who you are. You are a son. And as long as you're a son, you are entitled to the full rights of sonship. One of the rights of sonship is inheritance. The other right of sonship is covering. The other right of sonship is identity. The other right of sonship is that you are entitled to inherit the Father. The other right of sonship is that you are entitled to carry on the name and the legacy of the Father. Hear me, child of God. If we will exercise dominion, we must understand that we are sons of God. We must operate from the platform of faith, and we must operate from the law of prayer, the principle of prayer. And we will not pray like children. We will not pray like people, you know, like vagabonds. We will not pray like bastards, people that don't have a father. We will not pray like people that don't understand. We will pray like sons. Sons are people that have a father, and you have a father. His name is Jehovah. So you must put this in your prayer life and understand that as I pray for my business, I'm not praying for my business because I'm afraid. No, I'm praying for my business because I have confidence in the Father that He will do this for me. I speak a blessing in your life. I speak a blessing in your endeavors. I speak a blessing in your pursuit in life. And I pray for you that this understanding, this knowledge, this wisdom will come into your life, that you will understand that you are the rightful person to actualize the dominion of God here on the earth. He has said, let us, that was His responsibility to create you, but the responsibility of establishing dominion, extending it to the uttermost parts of the earth, is not with God, it's with you. So take this dominion, take this dominion now, utilize it in your business, utilize it in the labor of your hands, utilize it upon the fruit of your womb, utilize it in your ministry, utilize it in your projects, use this dominion. Now start something of higher magnitude, understand God said, let them. So I want you to understand it is your responsibility, it is your work, it is your mandate, it is your assignment. There are things that God is not doing here on the earth. It is men and women that understand dominion that are doing them here on the earth. Now, I will say this. In Exodus chapter number 14, when God is bringing the children of Israel and He wants them to go through the Red Sea, it is not God who parted the Red Sea. It was Moses. God told Moses, okay, let me read, because now, at times you sense now like, really? Which Bible are you reading, man of God? And what did you say your name is? Okay, go to Exodus chapter number 14. Exodus number 15. The Lord says to Moses, wherefore, why are you crying unto me? Speak unto the children of Israel that they go forward, but lift your rod, stretch out thine hand over the sea, and divide it. Bang, it is right there. Verse number 16, that sounds like Apostle David Jr. Verse number 16, it says, but lift, if this was the rod of Moses, God tells Moses, lift thou up thy rod and stretch out thine hand over the sea. He says, lift thou up thy rod and stretch out thy hand over the sea and divide it. You, Moses, divide it. The way God has ordained things is that when you move, He moves. When you move, He moves. Exodus chapter number 3. Exodus chapter number 3, the beginning part of it. Exodus chapter number 3, verse number 4. Now, it says this, in verse number 2, and the angel of the Lord appeared unto him in a flame of fire out of the midst of a bush. And he looked, and behold, the bush burnt with fire, and the bush was not consumed. Moses says, I will now turn aside and see this great sight. Why the bush is not burnt? Look at verse number 4. The Bible says, and when the Lord saw that he turned aside to see, and when the Lord saw that Moses stand aside to see. Most of the time we say that we are waiting on God. My friend, God is waiting on you. Because He has already said, let them have dominion. So if the moment you arise to take dominion, the Lord arises with you. The moment you open up your mouth to say, The Lord puts words in your mouth. That's what he tells them in Luke chapter number 12. He tells them, when you come before the authorities, don't worry what you will say. The Lord will give you what to say. So most of the time we are waiting for God, but God is telling us, arise and shine. He is not saying, I have arose, so arise. No, God is saying, child of God, arise. He has done everything there is to do for us to walk, for you to walk in dominion, for me to walk in dominion. So what is remaining is for us to arise. So understand, that's why he tells Job, do you know the laws that governs the heavens? Because if you knew the laws that governs the heavens, you can establish my dominion on the earth. So the people that will establish the dominion of God here on the earth are the people that understand Genesis 1:26. Let them have dominion. Your business is going down. You have the power, the authority, the dominion to raise it back up again. Things are not working out and not looking good for you. You don't have a job, financially you're struggling. Please hear me. God is not sending money to anyone. Heaven does not operate an M-Pesa account. The Bible says in Deuteronomy chapter number 8, verse number 18, he giveth power to make wealth. So everything that we need to see changing here on the earth, God has released it into the hands of a man. Are you that man that will establish God's dominion here on this earth? I position myself that I will establish God's dominion for healing, God's dominion for lifting, God's dominion for wealth, God's dominion for prosperity, God's dominion for revival, God's dominion for awakenings. I position myself because he has said, let Steve bring revival in our times to the uttermost parts of the earth. He has said, let this lady, I don't know your name may be Lucy, he said, let Lucy, let Jackie, let Marcy, let them have dominion in the earth. I want you to understand, most of the responses that we are looking for, they are not in the heavens. They are within our sphere and our scope. They are within our reach. God has said, let them have dominion. Let them have dominion. Let them have dominion. Before we cry out to God, we must ask ourselves, have we exhausted the dominion that he has given unto us? Am I saying that God is not in the picture? No. But understand, there is a way that things work. God is a God of order. And that is what the Bible says in 1 Corinthians chapter number 14, that everything must be done with a lot of decency and with a lot of order, because our God is not the order of confusion. Understand, God never created Adam before he created the earth, because Adam was not to, you know, was not to float in a vacuum. Adam was a man, he was to stand on solid ground. God never created the fish before he created the waters. Read Genesis chapter number 1. God separated the waters first. He created the waters, separated the waters before he told the waters to release and to bath the fish in them. God is a God of procedure, and this is the procedure. God created you in his image and in his likeness, and you must tap into that image. You must tap into that likeness. What God is saying, let them. It is after you let them, it is after, you know, you come into play, that now he also barks. That is where God tells Jeremiah in Jeremiah 1 verse number 12, that I'm watching over my word that I may perform it. Acts chapter number 4 verse number 29 and 30. Acts chapter number 4, verse number 29 and 30. He says this. Now, Acts chapter number 4, verse number 29, he says, and now, Lord, behold their threatenings. Grant unto thy servants that with boldness first they will speak thy word. Please look at the procedure. The disciples are threatened, but they don't tell God to intervene. No, they are threatened. They know God has said, let them. Jesus told them, as the Father has sent me, John 20 verse number 21, as the Father has sent me, so send I you. So they tell the Father, this is what we want you to do, that grant us boldness, the audacity, the boldness, the braveness, the confidence that we may speak your word. Look at the second thing, in verse number 30, they say, but now, and for you, you will stretch forth your hand and you will heal. The signs, wonders will be done in the name of thy holy child, Jesus. Look at the procedure. That Father, allow that we can speak first with boldness, then you will come and back your word. God told Jeremiah 1 verse number 12, that I'm watching over my word, that I may prove it, that I may perform it. Someone has to arise for God to confirm his word, for God to do something. Someone has to arise. A Jephthah has to arise. A Gideon has to arise. A Deborah has to arise. A Samson has to arise. A David has to arise. An Elijah has to arise. An Elisha has to arise. Someone has to arise. A Peter has to arise. A Paul has to arise. But most of us are waiting for God to do things, yet we're not positioning ourselves in a place where we can establish and guarantee and exercise dominion. Can I say this? God is working on the earth through men and women that knows the laws of the heavens. I will say that again. God is lifting businesses. God is blessing marriages. God is blessing people financially. God is bringing a lot of deliverance, salvation, and healing on the earth. But he is doing it through men and women that understand that God has already said, my responsibility is to create you in my image and in my likeness. Your responsibility is to function like me. Let me do this, child of God. I have a tablet here. It's a Samsung tablet. Now, the God of this tablet is called Samsung. The God of this tablet is called Samsung. Now, for this Samsung gadget to operate, it doesn't make any calls to the Samsung factory that is in China or wherever Samsung you are. I don't know where Samsung you are. If you know where you are, Samsung, please tell me where you are. I'll be very happy. But you don't just tell me with words, you tell me with gifts. Now, this gadget does not refer to the Samsung factory. Alfie is laughing. Now, this Samsung gadget does not refer to Samsung factory. It was manufactured to operate in a particular way. Even right now, it is functioning in that particular way. It is the same thing with our God. He created us to function in his image and in his likeness. What we have done is that we have refused to take that knowledge and gain that truth. That is why Jesus told them, you shall know the truth. Now, know this truth, this our child of God, that God created you to function in dominion. Now, start functioning in dominion. If it is a business you're starting, start it tomorrow. You don't have enough capital, start it tomorrow. The dominion that you carry will work things out. It will work things out. It will work things out. I speak a blessing into your life. I think I had already done that. I speak a blessing into your life. And I beseech you, I challenge you, function in your domain with the dominion of God. And thank you for joining us. Thank you for sharing these sermons. Thank you for tagging friends. Thank you for being our friends on Facebook. Thank you for every now and then you keep coming. I thank God for the men of God and the women of God that are coming out and that are listening to this broadcast. I'm so honored. I'm so humbled. So many men of God that are coming to this. And thank you so much for the feedbacks. The Lord bless you. The Lord honor you. Even as we come to the end of this week, I speak into your life. Operate in your scope of dominion. God has said, let them understand that the responsibility of raising and lifting you is within your scope. God has already said, let them become millionaires, let them be married, let them have children, let them rise, let them be favored. God has already given us the permission, let them. And I say to you this hour, let you function, become. God said, let there be. And I command into your life, let there be, let there be, let there be finances, let there be peace, let there be favor, let there be healing, let there be lifting, let there be settlement. And that I pray in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Ghost. My name, Pastor Steve. The Lord bless you. We see you around. Thank you so much.